just tell you about imposter syndrome, and let me tell you, give the last talk. I feel that 90% of what we work on, what I always say, has already been said in these amazing 2 days. I hope you also find 10% that's me. So, I work in the project Opening Microbial Research at the University of Münster in Germany. What I want to talk about today, I want to talk about ex vivo research compendium, which is our concept to grasp the challenges of reproducibility, and then provide some technical background for that, and also imagine how involved with ERCs as we call them might look like. I also want to quickly plug that my boss is looking for a postdoc, so if you do something with geo or know people who work in geoinformatics, it's a great position. Feel free to share this. So, the ex vivo research companion. We see this as, you could call it bundle or package. We started calling it ex vivo research companion because other people came up with the idea of a research companion. And of course, when you worry about reproducibility, in our case, when I say reproducibility, I always mean quotation of reproducibility. You think about executability. So what is in this compendium? Let's start at the bottom, there's the data. So for us, this compendium is complete. We don't assume that the data is somewhere else or is loaded by an HTTP connection or something like that. That of course means that for many problems we don't have an answer. So if you have big data sets that are too large to be replicated, look somewhere else. Then there's the software, which for us includes like the script that a user has written, but also the runtime environment, and that's where Docker comes in. Next is documentation, which in our case could be some README file, but also always includes the actual scientific publication, which is kind of documentation for the analysis you do. And at the very top we have an idea called UI bindings, and that is that if we have this compendium that has the data, the code, so everything's there, we have the runtime environment, we can also make the analysis interactive. We can actually a reader or a reviewer can change assumptions that the original researcher made and rerun everything. And to my mind, these UI bindings are also a very good additional documentation, because they are authored by the original researcher, and the original researcher says these are the parameters that you are most likely interested in changing. And there's a paper about that if you're interested. So, key features. We have kind of a nested containers concept. So we have a Docker container for the runtime environment, and we use Bagit as the other container, which basically is a standard from the preservation domain. Who has heard about Bagit before? Okay, yeah, you guys at least. That's why you also think of we're a librarian ready a little bit. So we have librarians in the project, and really the idea is give people something that they can understand, so we'll just put in required metadata in different formats, and your eyes will glow if I say next and premise and stuff like that.
Kind of.
That's not really concept.
So I think that's something that sets our companion a little bit apart from the other projects you've seen these 2 days, that we also think about what happens when everything is finished. Because we, that's also puts ourselves in the reproducibility range that we worry about is a time frame that you can reasonably assume the Docker still exists. And also that things are still, people would still be interested to reuse things. Right? So if you archive something and a science historian looks at things that are 50 years old, do we really think that this this person wants to take a piece of code and just edit it and do something new with it? Probably not. So this is a different use case. So that's why we limit ourselves as well a little bit. Because we want these things in the containers still to be interesting, so that people might switch out the data set and rerun the whole thing and analysis with their own data. Right, so it's close and complete. We think about, even if many people talk about HPC problems, we think that there are still many problems that people solve with a laptop, a desktop computers, and that's what we want to solve. So, lifetime, runtime of a few hours, a long desktop computer, those are the problems that we want to tackle. And we also do focus on the geospatial domain and the right now programming with R. So the idea is, of course, not limited to that, but the last 10, maybe 20% of getting things to work, we've learned that these are really domain specific. It just boils down to installing a specific library that might be very tricky. Okay. So how do we do that when we work with ESCs? Basically, there's two main use cases we have. One is creating them, and if an ERC exists, what you can do with it. And our the whole goal is, of course, to reduce the work that the model scientist has to do. So this is how our testing platform looks like. It has basically these two use cases. On the left-hand side, you can create an ERC. We imagine that works by you just putting in the URL to some shared hosting service, or you inspect it, which would be an identifier or a URL to an archive. So right now we work with Skibo, which is my university's own cloud-based provider, and we store things in Zenodo just because we had to start with something. But of course, any other archive would be possible, but we're just saying we don't store anything. So, I work on the creation of ERC. My colleague Marcus mostly works on the inspection, which means you can manipulate and interact data with the data. So if you're interested in that, interacting with these compendia, I'll connect you with Marcus. I will continue to talk about the references. Okay. So what does this creation process look like? A researcher submits a workspace. So we're thinking here about more scripters and coders. So I think if people use the Scylla tool, the creating markdown file is just what we would assume now people start with, or we start with. We try to do some magic in the background and extract metadata, which also includes that we look for file, geospatial data files, and try to extract their geospatial extent and temporal extent, for example. Look for author information, maybe stuff like that. All trying to reduce the amount of work that researchers do. And we've made some good progress there. So we've learned how far we can actually reduce the things that a researcher has to enter manually. Then we execute the analysis for two reasons. One is to check if what we got, what is uploaded, is actually the same thing as if we execute the analysis on our server. And we also do that for capturing the runtime environment. So we want to create the Docker file and the Docker image for the researcher. And well, then a user has to look at the metadata. Is that what we extracted actually correct? We cannot know that. We also don't know if the research makes sense, obviously. And then we publish that, which for us means that we put it somewhere else where it's actually preserved. Okay, now maybe I want to mention two tools that we use in the background, but they might also be interesting as standalone. One is a new R package called Containerit, which basically creates Docker files based on different R sessions or R markdown files and R configurations. So how does it work? In this case, it's the command line version. So I just say in the top line, I say container it for a file, and the file name is sf.r. It executes the file and looks afterwards in how does the session look like, what packages are loaded, and all the use that to create an image that is able to execute a given R script or R markdown file. And we use that in the background to do just that. We also have the meta tool suite, which does tries to do some reasonable guessing of author information, etc. Might even contact third-party services with the title of the paper to get author information, get an ORCID, things like that. So this is developed by my colleague Mark, who's working at the University of State Library, and yeah, really tries to find out as much as possible so that users in the end just see this and not actually in this form. So this is our current prototype with the required metadata, and you see this was actually a workspace we could expect not much, but we have an author and a title and everything else, all the information that the user has to enter by hand. But we want to do this only once, so we are going to ask for all the metadata that's needed to publish things, for example, to Zenodo and Figshare. So if there's different fields, we try to make a good reasonable set to support most use cases. And that's where things end up in our case, in the community on Zenodo. Okay, just a repetition of the process. Maybe a few words on the technical background. We developed a specification for the ERC, which is just technical, so that we also know what we're doing. We went through a few iterations, so we came up with a draft, and created these ERC by hand. Went back to the draft, got some expert feedback. We're going to do an evaluation with architects from the publishing domain to see if they understand it and can work with it. And then hopefully soon we're going to publish the next version that's a bit more stable, and we can then implement in our reference implementation. And all of this is online, so you can take a look at that. But the key features of how the ERC looks like today is that basically we have a base directory, not too much. We have something called a main document, which could be our markdown file, could be our script. We also have a display file, so what do we show to the user? Could be an HTML file, could be a PDF. And then we have the execution environment in two ways. One is the runtime image, and one is the runtime manifest. So in practically, that's for us a Docker image and a Docker file. I think that's also interesting from a preservation perspective. I like the Docker file because it describes what is there. So even if I cannot run the image anymore, I at least have a reasonably complete description of what's there. And then I have a configuration file in plain text that we use, and most importantly, contains control statements so that the system basically knows what to do with this image file. So in the end, it's supposed to be rather small. It should be able to create by hand. It's five files plus everything that you need, your libraries, your scripts, your data. So we actually don't care that if you upload a workspace that has this, you all remember this, this is not versioning slide with the different file names. We don't care about that, as long as you tell us which is the file we should use, or we can guess the right file. We will take all the rush as well, just start. So not trying to reproduce everything that exists. We've created an architecture where we place ourselves in the current application process. So what we are not going to create another platform, we're not going to replace existing publishers, but we developed this reproducibility service, which basically does two things: create ERCs and allows users to inspect, manipulate, work with these ERCs. And these are then supposed to be connected to existing publishing platforms. We are using existing solutions to store the ERCs, repositories, etc. So I'll skip over that, but yeah, this, the main message is we're trying to add one small building block and not solve everybody's problems. So how could the world with ERCs look like? I mentioned the inspection. It's not just a PDF that you get, but something that you can work with interactively. We also have a few hacks, so it would be nice, of course, if I go to my publisher and sort of to my cloud hosting solution, and then I just can click there, create ERC from this directory, I want to download things. And of course, the logo will at some point have nice labels that says this is the valid ERC. And of course, when we have this information, all the metadata that's more, a lot more than just this is the paper, this is the author on the year. We actually have information about is this research executable, what kind of software is used, etc. The world of current, how you find, how you find research might actually change, because we can then say this is, to all these different platforms, add information that is related to reproducibility and executability. So we had a nice student project with a clear Chrome extension to hack all these different research websites and add a bunch of badges to them. Okay, so I'm going to jump to the outlook. So somebody said yesterday that there's a lot of new work around the edges, and that's really also what we do with our research compendia. What we're going to do next is that we try to keep up with our reference implementation, which is mostly based on JavaScript and of course Docker containers, with the use specification, and create more demo cases, and spin out different interesting tools, such as the two that I mentioned, and of course start more follow-up works. Everybody has a lot of ideas what we could do with this. Many things that were mentioned, like having interactive collaborations based on this concept, etc., is something we want to do.